Good evening, everyone. I'm Ryan Thomas from Earthkeepers Connect Goa, your host for this evening, the 11th day of the pre-summit webinars leading up to the New Earth Summit in November, the second edition of India's first integrative summit on solutions to our problems in health, food, farming, and environment. I extend a warm welcome on behalf of our summit convener, Daryl D'Souza, and also on behalf of our 10 Earthkeeper groups in India and overseas, to our esteemed panelists of this evening, and we express our gratitude to you for taking out time from your busy schedules to be with us and to share your wisdom so that all watching this webinar and its recording later may understand more deeply about a spiritual and holistic way of life that benefits not only all the people of the earth, but also Mother Earth and Father Sky. Our topic for today is healthy food for a healthy life. I will start with introducing the panelists to the audience. Daryl D'Souza. Daryl D'Souza's reversal from 14 years of sickness to a state of complete well-being within just 1 year of using integrated natural therapies is a story that has inspired millions across the globe lead healthier lives. His book, Become Healthy or Extinct, on curing chronic illnesses with integrated natural therapies, finds readership in close to 200 countries. Daryl does disease reversal workshops as well as spiritual workshops all across India. He has also served a 5-year term as the Secretary of the World United Doctors and Healers Association. He hosts platforms and events for doctors, healers, and therapists to work together and has curated and convened 4 mind, body, and spirit healing conferences. Daryl is also an organic farmer and environmentalist, a TEDx speaker, a founder of the Earthkeeper Connect, an ambassador of Vegan Nation, convener of the New Earth Summit, and a speaker at the Parliaments on Spirituality. Dr. Rima Arora is a clinical dietitian, nutritionist, and body transformation specialist, winner of Best Nutritionist Award 2019 and nutrition partner with IFI, Beauty Pageant and Fashion Web Series, and Collision of Crowns, world's first face-off for crown winners. Being the founder of Food Synergy, a complete diet and nutrition studio, her approach is to give customized diet and nutrition plans, keeping the medical conditions, routine, and activity on track. She also offers diet and nutrition services to the people across the globe. Her expertise is to help patients in reversing all sorts of chronic illnesses like diabetes, hypertension, hyperthyroidism, hyperkrishima, PCOD, autoimmune conditions, and vertigo, skin and hair issues, allergy issues, respiratory problems, acid reflux, IBS, constipation, obesity, overweight, underweight, hormonal disorders, Alzheimer's, etc., with an integrative approach. Siddharth Shukla, ethical vegan since the last 6 years, after reading Daryl's book, Become Healthy or Extinct, it also kickstarted his spiritual journey as well. Having completed Ironman Malaysia on a vegan diet and completed many long distance runs, he is a certified nutritionist and health coach in Mumbai. His journey from being fat to triathlete is quite interesting, which he always loves to share about. Professionally, he is a human resource consultant, but always tries to include health aspect in whatever he does. He believes that the spiritual journey starts with a healthy body. Dr. Shikha Agarwal. Dr. Shikha Agarwal has been the practicing physician and health educator at Healthy Healing Goa since 2005. She has successfully treated thousands of patients who have come to her with a great variety of ailments, including serious complicated cases. Dr. Shikha is a member of the Indian Medical Association. In 2006, she passed her postgraduate degree in holistic health, issued by Apollo Hospitals. Since May 2007, Dr. Shikha holds the degree of CMT, or Clinical Metal Toxicologist. In June 2019, Dr. Shikha has also become a member of the Institute of Functional Medicine. We will now begin the three rounds of questions for our panelists that will conclude in 1 hour, so that we can keep the next hour for Q&A with the audience. Accordingly, I request each panelist to address each question in a maximum of 5 minutes. To our audience, if you would like to receive the recorded video of this webinar, please visit earthkeepersconnect.org and click Allow to Notifications from our mobile news app. You can also subscribe to our YouTube channel, The New Earth Summit, for the recording of this webinar. Our audience need not wait for 7 p.m. to type their questions in the Q&A box below. So here is our first question for the panelists. It is estimated that nearly 70% of all chronic illnesses like high BP, cholesterol, diabetes, heart disease, obesity, arthritis, hormonal imbalance, etc., are caused by the wrong foods, while lifestyle choices and stressed mental and emotional states contribute to the balance 30%. Why do you think most people are not clear about what healthy food is? So, Siddharth Shukla, would you like to take this?
Very good evening to all of you. Thank you, Daryl, for giving me an opportunity like this. Always grateful to you. And regarding this question, yeah, this is a very important question to start off this evening. And I'll just talk about my personal journey in this regard. According to me, the biggest problem, rather, I would like to say, is the market we have around us. Okay, so yes, most of the diseases and most of the illnesses are closely associated with the food that we eat. And subconsciously or consciously, we are aware of, okay, that what food I should eat. The everyone is now aware that I should eat a lot of fruits, we should eat vegetables, we should eat unprocessed food. But the problem is the market. We get influenced by the market around us, and a lot of myths are there. Then a lot of things are even though people are following a healthy diet, they are restricted themselves to taking protein supplements, and there is huge market of supplements now. Okay, the kind of lifestyle we have adopted is also that has to be corrected, obviously, because eating is now our somewhere it is the last priority. So before we discuss about what to eat and what not to eat, we should understand what is eating and how we should eat. That is the most important thing as far as I know, which I have imbibed in my lifestyle. So yes, I believe that market is the biggest culprit, the marketing we have around us, the advertisements, then we have TV and everything. So we have actually created a cloud of so much of stuff that we cannot see things clearly. So this is how I feel.
Thank you. Dr. Rima, would you like to take it up?
Hi, good evening, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank Mr. Daryl D'Souza for inviting me as a co-panelist for pre-summit of the New Earth Summit. I feel it's a great initiative by Daryl and his team. It's been 7 years I am working as a clinical dietitian and nutritionist. Now, in this journey, I happen to meet most of the patients who are suffering from chronic disease or lifestyle disorders, whether it's hypertension or diabetes or hyperuricemia or thyroid, PCOD, PCOS, the list goes on and on. And in all these practices, I felt that there is a major missing link. There is a major gap in between. In spite of the fact I was trying to design best of the plans for my patients, here I would like to add that I just don't design diet plans. I basically believe in giving health transformation plans because I feel health is a holistic approach. So I try to integrate everything, be it their food practices, the methods of cooking, what kind of utensils they are using, their sleep cycle, water cycle, activity cycle, everything, you know, I take care while designing their plans. But in spite of designing the best of the plans, the immediate quotient, the immediate need arises in mine and my patient's mind is that from where they are going to source all these foods. And that's the point we immediately felt the interdependence of food and the environment. And that's why I so resonated well with this concept of the New Earth Summit, where he's trying to give a global or a holistic approach and try to cover everything related to health, whether it's air, water, or whether it's the quality of the earth, every single thing is being taken care of. So I'm so thankful to Mr. Darren for keeping me in a loop in this beautiful journey. Now coming to the question that 70% of the chronic disorders are due to bad food choices and rest 30% is due to bad lifestyle choices. Well, as a clinical dietitian, I can completely vouch on it. Because so far I have treated more than 1,000 patients and 98% of my patients are suffering from one or the other chronic disorder. In my practices, whenever I meet any of my patients, I try to get into their life history. I try to know every single aspect of their life, like what time they get up, what time they sleep, their activity cycle, how they respond to the stress on day-to-day basis, what kind of food they eat, what kind of ingredients they use, what are their cooking methods. I try to know every single thing. And trust me, it makes, you know, so visible and so apparent that why and how they actually manifest these chronic disorders. It's certainly due to the bad lifestyle and bad food choices they were making in their past. Now, the question is that why they are not able to, see that what healthy food is all about. I strongly feel, you know, that we humans are going away from the nature, our very own existence of ours. I would like to say that we are not just human beings, we are nature beings. And we cannot go away from the nature. Our very own existence is from the nature. Like, for example, our body comprises of trillions of cells. And every single cell is basically coming from all the basic five elements, that is earth, water, fire, earth, space, and water. So if you really want to nourish your cell, your sources should come from all these natural five basic elements. And I guess that's the basic missing link. People have gone so far from their nature that they are not able to imagine that what actually, what is the true food to them. If you really want to nourish your cells, if you want to go for the right kind of food choices, you have to understand from where you are coming. You have to understand what's your basic existence is all about. For example, we need sun. We all know that what is the importance of sun in our life. For example, we need vitamin D, and vitamin D has various roles to play. And the major source for vitamin D is sun. And it's not just the vitamin D, even your digestion is getting controlled with sun. But the kind of lifestyle we all are living, we are so away from the nature, you know. We are all the time in the closed four walls, in the air-conditioned environment. So we are so away from the nature that we end up manifesting so many issues in our body. So that till the time we are not connected with our very own existence, till the time we don't realize that we are nature beings, the choices will go wrong. So if you want to make the correct food choices, you have to start resonating everything from nature. Whatever is coming from nature, in the most raw and wholesome form, that's the only food for human body. You know, like, you will be amazed to know that 80 to 90% foods available in superstores are not worth eating. They are not worth eating at all. Whenever patients come to me, the very first advice I give to my patients is that make sure that your 80 to 90% of food is getting sourced from the local vendors. you know, these sabji wala, bhaji walas, or the local vendors and hawkers around you. And 10 to 20% you can get from the superstores. But unfortunately, it's vice versa. People are, you know, most of the time fetching all those packet foods, all those processed refined foods. And that's the very main reason they all are manifesting these chronic disorders. So the moment you realize that you are not supposed to get into something which man is producing, because whatever is available in the superstore is all man-made. They all are processed, refined items. That's not the food which our body or our cells are looking for. Okay, so I'll just conclude. So that's, I guess, the prime reason I answered my question that why people are not able to identify the correct food, because they are away from the nature and they are definitely dependent more on the man-made things. So that's the prime reason.
Thank you, Dr. Rima. Dr. Shikha, would you like to answer this, please?
So I totally agree with Dr. Rima. It's that we are not connected to nature. That is one of the main reasons. And other reason that I find that why people are not able to identify nowadays, or there's so much confusion about which is healthy food and which is not, is because there's too many different views. You go to ordinary doctors, they will tell you, you should drink milk because it is full of proteins, it's full of calcium. You come to me, I'll tell you, don't drink milk. You go to an Ayurvedic physician who's practicing, you know, in India for a long time, he will say, no, no, you have to drink milk. So people are getting, and then you watch ads, which will tell you strong bones for your children, you have to drink milk. So there are too many confusing views around us about which food is healthy for us and which food is not healthy for us. So how is one to decide? So the reason, the thing is that milk actually is food. Of course, our babies need milk. We need milk. The reason why milk has become from being a food to being a non-food, main reason I can put it into two or three categories, basically. One is the quality of what you can say, the food, the quality has changed. When I was a child, when we bought milk, I used to go to a place where there were cows and they would milk the cows in front of me. There's milk of one cow, unpasteurized, unsterilized, whatever, no homogenization, nothing done. It wasn't toned. So it was full milk, you boil it, so that will pasteurize it. It will remove the cream from top, it will tone the milk. So you had natural milk, so that was still digestible. But the milk now you get in the market is in a packet, or you don't know where the source is. So thousands of cows milked put together. In order to increase the milk, there are hormones in it, there's antibiotics in it. On top of it, it is sterilized and it's pasteurized. Pasteurization totally denatures proteins in the milk. So your body is not going to digest that milk anymore. So now milk has become unhealthy. So the confusion is very easy for people because milk, which was healthy, has now become unhealthy. Second reason is we don't move enough. So foods which our grandparents could digest, we can't digest anymore. The choices have become difficult. You know, you have a laborer, you give him anything, he's going to extract nutrition from it because the body needs nutrition. We have plenty of excess of food. Everything we are eating so much food. How are we going to get nutrition? Because we already have so much in our system. Our body becomes choosy. So the choices of foods have become limited now. If you work very hard, you go, you walk so much, you do 3 hours of gym every day, you will see a lot of people eat a lot of rubbish and they're still healthy. So the healthy food, the definition really depends upon where you choose the food from, what kind of a gut health you have, do you move enough, and to top it all, are you using organic or you're using pesticide rich food? Because that actually comes almost in the end, because if your body is strong, it may be able to get rid of a lot of poisons. But if your body is not strong, you can eat whatever you want, your body is going to react to it. So that is why there is a confusion. You need to connect to your body to understand what your body can take. What your body can take is the healthy food. What your body can't take is not healthy food. That's the first thing. That's how I treat my clients. I do not tell them straight away, you have to cut this, take out all these things and not just eat this. Half of my patients will never come back to me. I have to go according to what people can take, what they're able to take, and slowly move them to the foods their body likes. Whatever food the body likes is healthy, not the tongue. Don't go with the taste. There's a saying, eat to love, don't love to eat. It's very important. You need to eat that your body loves, not what your taste bud only. So healthy food means, as Dr. Rima said, connected to nature, raw form, the foods that your body can really digest well, enjoy, give you energy, vitality, and life. Whatever that food is, that is healthy. And whatever makes you sick is not healthy.
Thank you, Dr. Shekha. And Daryl, would you like to take this on?
Yes, thank you, Danan. And very wonderful views of our panelists, and I am in agreement with almost everything, but I will share some difference here with like a bird's eye view. Okay, so now we are, you know, modern civilization, and we are getting all our, you know, knowledge and education, and even about, you know, what is good food and what is not, from certain channels. So for example, books are a channel. Okay, who are the books written by? They're written by certain smarter human beings. Okay, then we get the TV channel, and there's news coming out over there, you know, about food also. So food has become, we get different sources of food, and all of these sources, you know, are coming from experts of different, you know, or they have their different sources. And what is a healthy diet and what is not a healthy diet seems to be the most complex question only for one species on this planet. Okay. And that is the human being. So no other species on this planet, you know, has this question, what is a healthy food? And even amongst human beings, the people who are living in the jungle, okay, the indigenous tribes and all of those people, when you go and sit down to them, they never discuss, you know, what is healthy food and what is not healthy food. If you ask them about food, they'll just show you what is food. And for them, it's such a natural science. Now, why does this happen? Why do we need education? And why don't they need education? And so if I'm saying they are not educated like us, let us make another logical comparison. Well, they don't have high BP, cholesterol, diabetes, arthritis, obesity, hormonal imbalance, or cataract, glaucoma, nothing. Okay, they die slowly out of old age. Sometimes there's scarcity of food here and there and all that. So, you know, there are different conditions. And modern people of the world have kind of, you know, taken away their lands, cut down the forest, put them in corners. So they are suffering a lot. But even then they manage to live, and they don't need any, you know, education on food. So I think the main reason is, like Dr. Rima mentioned, so I'm going a little more literally, you know, in this modern civilization phase, we cut ourselves out from nature, and then we lost touch of, you know, what other species are doing, or even we can do in natural environment, because we are living in concrete jungles now, and we are living in completely unnatural environment. And we have forgotten the nutritional sciences. We are into certain things, engineer, this, that, and now all these TVs and our books and all, they cater to that much only. So we are cut off from these intelligences. And then obviously somebody has to come and tell us who's food. Now those people also, they are working in laboratories. They are working with chemicals and molecules and all in this artificial modern environment. And they are not people who are growing food. There are many people growing food on this planet. Some people are doing it well. Some people are not doing it well. Right. So for me, that's the primary thing, our disconnection from nature. And also our teachers who are trying to teach us about nutrition now, they also disconnected from nature. They're sitting in laboratories. I think that's the biggest problem. Okay. So another argument is put by people that, you know, tradition tells us, you know, over the many years, what if you look at our families and generations, then you will know what is food. For example, let me speak as an Indian. India is the, you know, diabetic capital of the world. And I've not seen official studies, but from what I see in hospitals and all these places, I think we are also the leaders in cataract surgery and knee replacement surgery. Okay. So all of these things, now I know they are reversible by diet, because I have been reversing all these conditions from people from 2005. So it's been like 15 years. So I don't buy this logic at all. In fact, I say the traditional diets of India have caused cataract, glaucoma, arthritis, obesity, hormonal imbalance, and you know, this knee problems also. And like Dr. Shikha mentioned, you know, about milk. So about these topics, all of my topics and even what is written in my book, I write them from, you know, living sciences. There was a time I was researching a lot of nutritionists and nutrition courses around the world. And before going for the course, I spoke to the person who came out of that college or that course. And I asked them certain fundamental questions. And when they gave the answers, I said, you tell me where this is happening in nature. For example, milk. Okay. There's no mammal on the planet who is having milk after the age of 4 years. Okay, so I said, you show me any other species, show me the apes, okay, show me the chimpanzee, the monkey, show me any of them who are drinking milk after the age of 4 years. And if it's happening, see, logically, it can't happen because the mother stops lactating after 2-3 years, right? So only God has to come and give them milk, otherwise they can't get milk. We are such smart species that we think something is wrong with the design that God has given us. So we run after another species and we take the cow's milk. Even the cow mother, she also makes milk for only 3-4 years. And then it stops. So I look at very fundamental things, and I am much in agreement with what Dr. Rima says, that if we look in nature, we will see natural foods. I have a TEDx talk on that. You know, it's actually about what is food for human beings. And I would urge everybody, you know, who's watching this video to, you know, Google it up. And there's an experiment over there which I give, which every human being can do, and even, you know, you can do it, and you will realize that that experiment really tells us what is food for human beings. And it worked, I say, right from the time Adam and Eve, the first human beings, till the time, you know, it'll work for every one of us and 10,000 years in the future also. So for me, nutritional science is very simple, but it becomes simple if you will look at natural things, you will look at nature, you look at what's growing in the season, what is available in your local, you know, fresh vegetables, fruits, nuts, beans, seeds, peas, all those roots, you know, the market. And I think the most damaging food in the world is what is there in the malls, because all these packaged and processed foods, you see, they are made by these geniuses from the laboratories, okay? So I think that's the biggest threat. And because of all these misguidances, unfortunately, people, you know, they are feeding on this incorrect information. And so obviously their idea about food is pretty wrong. So that's why all of us have to, you know, get together and get deep into these subjects. And the bottom line is, you know, not theories, but when you put it into practice and you see people recovering from illnesses in, you know, with my healthy diet, people reverse all these conditions in 2-3 months. So that diet is the right diet that can, you know, cure people like that quickly. Thank you.
Thank you, Dara. And our second question for the panelists is, what is healthy food according to you, and how do you help your clients reverse illnesses with these right food choices and also achieve higher levels of health and fitness in life? Siddharth, would you like to go ahead and start?
Before I start answering this question, I would like to share a bit of my journey. So, what kind of food? I was a person, I think previous to prior to 2015, I was a hardcore non-veg eater. I was flat, fat, plump, and my weight was 89 kgs. I was not able to run even for 100 meters. And the problem was the same. I was just, I was hypnotized by the taste buds and the market around me and the social lifestyle which we have. Okay. I always loved my tandoori chicken and all that. And it happened that I started reading Dara's book. Actually, that book was ordered by my wife, Ms. Disha. But I actually read that book, and some shocking facts were revealed to me. Okay. As Dr. Shikha has mentioned about milk, that was the biggest shock of my life. I had a history of kidney stones, you know, and I had 4 operations to get rid from it. So when I researched, I was studying a lot, and I was not able to find the reason behind kidney stones, the reoccurrence of kidney stones. And doctors were telling me to drink milk every day, okay? Because according to them, my body had a tendency of, you know, collecting calcium and getting it combined with some oxalate and whatever. So when I stopped drinking milk and having other stuff, my problem related to kidney stone was gone. I didn't have a single stone after that. And though, so biggest reason was milk, because of my illness, because of my, you know, the kidney stone issue and other health ailments I was suffering with. So what kind of food? Yes, I would like to say that we all have to do a lot of research if we are suffering from some illness, or even if we want to lose our weight, or we have some chronic illness. The food is, the first prime food is sun, okay? As Dr. Rima had already mentioned, the prime food, source of food is sun. Every day, 10 to 15 minutes in the sunlight is the first major thing which we all can do. Then what I changed in me is I moved more into fruits and vegetables from local vendors or wherever I have access to organic stuff. 80% of my diet was inclusive of fruits and vegetables, and cooked food was 20 to 30% only. And that too, it was not a complicated stuff like this recipe and that recipe. I just stopped having refined oil and milk and the salt and the sugar. Yeah, sugar is another biggest culprit, okay, behind all illnesses and all. We were talking about diabetes and arthritis. Yeah, sugar is the culprit. So I stopped eating these basic stuff, and I moved into, I get to actually, the kind of people approach me are athletes who want to run marathons, and people from day-to-day life who want to lose weight. So I first guide them on their lifestyle and their food habits, try to understand their cravings, you know, carbohydrates, people have a lot of carbohydrate cravings, they want to, you know, and in our Indian system is like that, until we are not eating rotis and rice, we are not feeling full. So we have to, I try to make them understand that whatever we are eating are actually carbohydrate. You have to shift to healthy options like fruits and vegetables. And for athletics, we have special needs. And I have a very limited time to discuss all that stuff. So I will just give an example, and with that, I will end my discussion over here. When we go to the gym, okay, we see people, they are pushing weights and doing that, and they immediately having protein. Now, no one tells them that our body immediately needs glucose because of muscle fatigue and the breakup of muscles, which happens while exercising. So immediate requirement is the glucose, which we will get from fruit, is the best source. But protein we will require at a later stage in the night when our body is at rest and the repairing is going to happen. So best time of taking protein is just before the sleep. You can have your protein shake, and then it will give a very good effect the person who want to build muscles and all. But instead of doing that, all are forced to drink a lot of protein powders and all that stuff just after doing exercise. So body is not getting proper glucose, and we are overloading it with protein. So a lot of things are there. So yeah, I will like to end my discussion with this. I will give time to other panelists. Thank you.
Thank you, Siddharth. Dr. Rima, would you like to take this part?
Well, now the question is that what is healthy food as for me, and how I am helping my patients to reverse all chronic illnesses? So as I said earlier, that we are nature beings. So whatever is coming from the nature in the most raw form, whatever is wholesome, whatever is in the natural state, whatever is available without any man-made manipulations. For example, if you talk about wheat is a natural food. But it's no more worth eating. Why? Because due to the sudden increase in the demand of wheat, we did a lot of crop revolution and a lot of, you know, like malfunctioning in this crop to cater the access need. Now, what happened in this process that the gluten content in wheat, there is one protein called gluten in wheat, it's increased to such an extent that it's creating inflammation in your gut lining. It's giving you acidity, bloating, and many more issues. And it's not just affecting you, it's affecting your DNA as well. And that is why a lot of kids are getting born with the issues called gluten intolerance. These poor kids, they never consume wheat, but still they are born with such disorders called gluten intolerance. So that's no more worth eating. It's natural, but still it's been manipulated by men to cater their, you know, greeds. So that's not something food as per me. Anything which is coming from the nature in a wholesome form, something which is not manipulated, like for example, nowadays a lot of GMOs are available, genetically modified foods. They are natural foods, but since they have been genetically modified, so they have lost all the nutrient content, and rather they are going to create a lot of toxicity in your system and you can never digest it. So that's no more a natural food. So something which is untouched, something which is coming directly from the nature, something which is wholesome, like vegetables, fruits, and nuts, seeds, legumes, anything which is not manipulated by men and coming directly from the nature in wholesome form, that's the food as per me. Now, how exactly I'm helping my patients in reversing the chronic illnesses? Because that's what my main profile is all about. So whenever my patients, they are coming to me, as I said earlier, I always try to know their history first. And the very first guidance I impart is that what is natural food? Because unfortunately, they have been brainwashed due to this food industry. Even the food supply chain has been affected to such an extent that they really don't know what natural food is all about. Like before getting into this profession, like almost 10 years before, my mother, she used to use this refined oils. And now when I go back and I just recall that, oh my God, my mother was using all those refined oils for cooking. So I can imagine what kind of damage it was, you know, giving to my system. Because refined oil is completely processed. That's how it gets refined. So you are not just in this process of refining, everything is refined. All the nutrition value is also refined. So I first of all guide my patients that what is natural food? Till the time you are keeping the foods in the natural state, they are natural. Apart from this, the very most important thing, which even Dr. Shikha mentioned, that people are overeating nowadays. They are consuming much more what their body is looking for. They are consuming much more than that. And they are not allowing their system to get into rest and digest phase at all. They are all the time in the phase of, you know, like fast, and just like keep on consuming things, be it a thought, be it a food, they're all the time engaged. They are keeping their system engaged. So they are not allowing their system to get into rest and digest mode. And till that time, they are not allowing their system to get into induced in this rest and digest, they cannot absorb anything even if they are consuming the best of the superfoods. So that's how I always try to introduce the concept of intermittent fasting also, where they have to bring a cycle to give a complete rest to their system. Not just the mouth, their brain as well, their eyes as well. So these are the basic practices I introduce. Now, even one more thing Dr. Shikha mentioned, that we cannot talk about extremes, otherwise they will never come back to you. So somewhere, yes, I'm struggling with this thing. For example, we humans are basically designed to follow sun cycle, which we call a circadian rhythm, where we are supposed to get up with the sunrise and finish our, like every single thing, not just like food, everything by sunset. But then the kind of work people are doing nowadays, they are very much active until midnight, 11. So they are not getting any, you know, like coordination with the nature at all. So initially, I definitely feel that, okay, if not the circadian rhythm, then at least have a fixed biological clock, where you should have a fixed wake up and bedtime, where you should have a fixed eating hours. And it's not just that, you have to go for the entire change where you have to introduce some sort of activity. You have to respect your sleep cycle, your water cycle, your food cycle. Everything has to be, you know, organized well. Then only you can expect them to go one step ahead where they are actually, you know, starting their journey. It's just an initials. It's just a beginning of, a journey of reversing their disease. And then slowly and gradually, I can introduce little more, you know, like changes in their life in terms of their nature of job, their work profile, where I can always, you know, encourage them to connect with the nature. Because the kind of work people are doing, they hardly get any exposure to fresh air, sunlight, not at all. So then they are just chugging all those supplements. Sometimes I also, you know, I mean, get into a situation where I have to prescribe supplements as a crutch. But I make them very clear that take it as a crutch. Eventually, if you really want to have a fit body and you want to reverse all these illnesses, you have to connect yourself with the nature. This is all how we encourage our patients to, you know, go back to the basics. And we can definitely reverse all these illnesses by bringing a kind of harmony in them. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rima. Dr. Shikha, would you like to take this forward?
Yeah. Adding on to what Dr. Rima and Siddharth said, I mean, I don't need to repeat any of that. What I would say is what consists of a healthy diet is you take care of every aspect of the nutrition that needs to be in the diet. I call it PFC-MVP, means you need to have proteins, fats, carbs, vitamins, minerals, and phytonutrients. All six elements should be in the diet. That would be called a healthy food. Dr. Rima and Siddharth have already talked about natural foods, eating more natural, so I don't need to discuss that. So the diet plan that people need to follow, need to look at when they're looking at any kind of a diet plan, whether it's a paleo diet or a vegan diet or a Mediterranean diet or whatever diet they follow, they need to make sure they have a balance and good quality of proteins in their diets, fats, carbohydrates. The food should also have minerals, vitamins, and good phytonutrients. Phytonutrients are the antioxidants or the colors of the foods which allow you to detox, which allow your body to clean up. So where do you get good proteins from? I am a proponent of mostly a vegetarian diet, with some people who may need to eat some animal proteins because they live in a cold climate. If you're coming from Canada, you may need some proteins in the form of animal proteins because the metabolism needs that. But a climate like India doesn't really need meat. So you get your proteins, good quality proteins, from foods which have plant foods. So you eat a lot of fruits, good quality, organic fruits. You take a lot of vegetables, and the vegetables need to be of all colors. Making sure you have about, say, around different 30 to 50 different colors of foods in a week is very important in order to be a part of healthy diet or healthy food choices. So vegetables and fruits of all colors. The same way, choosing protein sources, for example, making sure there is at least 30% protein in your diet. There should be like 50% carbs, 30% proteins, 20% fats, or maybe you can make it the other way around, depending on what kind of a person or problem they have, you could fiddle it around. So the carbs that you choose, the carbs have to be of a very high quality. When I say carbs, I do not mean maida. Maida is very bad. I don't mean sugar. Sugar is very bad. And fruits which are very high glycemic, coated with pesticides, like grapes or strawberries in India, because berries are very good, but strawberries in India are full of pesticides. So foods, you have to make these choices. You need to choose carbs. Like, you have to choose really good whole grains. I say millet is a good grain if somebody needs grains in their diet. Choose quinoa. Choose amaranth. You can choose ragi also, but try and avoid wheat. as Dr. Rima said, wheat is just not left as a food anymore for us because of whatever alteration has been done there. The same somewhere is with rice as well. Goans, all Indians, they eat rice. Rice. But it's in some people, it is very important to cut out rice. Rice is one of the grains that also carries arsenic in the kernel. It is the white rice especially can, it's starch. And starches are bad carbs. They're not really good carbs. So proteins, you have to choose good carbs and good fats. Fats you get from nuts and seeds, but not everybody can digest nuts and seeds very well. So choose good oils, unrefined oils, and especially, you know, healthy fats. If you want to cook, choose ghee, choose coconut oil. These are good oils for cooking. Or mustard oil in North India is used for cooking. Don't choose refined oils. Don't cook in unrefined olive oil. Don't cook in olive oil. Olive oil is good on salads. So you use olive oil on salads, use flaxseed oil, hemp oil. So they will give you good fats that your body needs. Minerals, vitamins, and phytonutrients will come when you choose fruits, vegetables, and different colors. So your diet should have a balance of each and every aspect. Choose food so that you know that you have enough of each ingredient in your diet. Every plate should have, what I said in my last lecture was, when you're choosing a plate, you make sure your grain portion, your rice portion, or whatever grain you want to eat is only making 30% of your plate. The rest 70% of your plate is filled with fruits and vegetables. And good fats, of course, which go into the cooking if you're eating cooked food. If you're eating a salad, that your salad goes with a major portion of your food. And rice and other things less. So this is how you would make a healthy diet, a healthy portion. And that's how I start treating my patients, educating them first. What is good food? Try create good portions. And then when you want to treat illnesses, then you go towards eliminating certain foods. You go for elimination diet. As Dr. Rima said, you will have to eliminate certain foods from the diet. You will eliminate wheat. You will eliminate the major allergens, basically. Wheat, milk, or dairy in any form. You will eliminate all kinds of white sugar. You will eliminate, you can do that at home, actually. Then you will eliminate soya. You will eliminate eggs. And you will eliminate all kinds of animal products, mostly seafood in Goa, and of course pork and lamb and everything. Avoid these six things for 3 weeks, and you will see a major shift in your health pretty much by avoiding them already. This is the beginning of doing a diet plan for people. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Shikha. Daryl, would you like to take this over?
Yes, Ranan, thank you. And I am in agreement with, again, you know, with most of what our panelists have said. And I would like to give some, other angles to this. Now, when I approach nutrition and, you know, teach about it, for example, my TEDx talk, it is, at the top level, I work at what is nutrition for human beings, right? And in that category, I see that if people go in nature and make natural choices, and you know, there is one of the laws that I mentioned in my TEDx talk, which is that God has provided for all living beings on this planet who eat any food, God has provided that food in its natural form. All that they have to do it is they have to find it and eat it. There is no such thing as cooking and, you know, modifying or mixing and all of those things. So these are the things that human beings have invented. And when we make a hodgepodge of all our food, it becomes toxic also and acidic also. And then we suffer the consequences. You know, in nature, animals follow a dietary system called the mono diet, meaning at one time they are just eating, you know, one kind of food only. And when they are satisfied with that, then they will go after some place and they will eat another food. So in a span of 2-3 days, they get all their nutrients from different things. Another thing that came out from that experiment of my TEDx talk, now it's not something that I'm just doing with myself. Like I said, every human being can do it. And if you do it sincerely, you will see there's a hierarchy of food. And one of the primary foods for human beings is, it starts with fruits. then vegetables and, you know, all plant-based foods, vegetables, nuts, beans, peas, seeds, roots, grains, all of that. And by natural choice, we do not eat raw meat. You know, the tiger eats it, the dog eats it, the cat eats it. And their teeth and the digestive system and their paws are all, you know, they're made like that to catch prey and to eat it. But, you know, we are not like that. And we don't have those canines and all. So there are many indicators, what I've explained in my book also, which clearly show that, you know, meats are not a natural food for human beings. So that's the first top level, you know, of food that I talk about. And of course, looking at natural sciences also, that's why from that natural science, you know, I also have realized that, you know, milks are not a natural thing that are available every time for us to eat, for us to drink. So after that level of nutrition, then the second level is about how pure and natural it can be. So organic, right? And if you can't get organic, at least, you know, go to your natural vegetable mart and all that, get real food. And what I'm against is, like Dr. Reema mentioned, that these manufactured foods by human beings. You see, I will just share something very deep experience that I had in deep meditative states with the plant kingdom. Okay, and the plant kingdom, I didn't know they could, you know, speak in telepathy, and by the time the messages reach, it becomes words in your mind. So the message that I got from plant kingdom is, they said that we create life on this planet. The only food producers are plants. We take from Mother Earth, from the soil and the water, and we bring it to our system. We go up to the skies, to Father Sky. We catch the air in a certain way. We bring in the sunlight. We put all of this together in photosynthesis, and we create food. And from that, the herbivorous animals eat that food. And then the carnivorous animals, they eat the herbivorous animals. Okay? So they say, first you understand this thing clearly, that we create food on this planet. And we have created human beings. And we have also created the animals and all of these species. Now, can you imagine if we stop creating food? What is going to happen to all of you people and animals? No food, right? Even the carnivorous animals will eat all the vegetarian animals, and if the vegetarian animals are not getting food after some time, they will die. So entire life on this planet comes to a standstill. So that was a very important message I got from them, that we create food. And why they were communicating to me, the second message is that human beings have started meddling with our molecules, and there are going to be consequences, and you're already seeing the consequences, because these things that we create food, it has been there for millions of years, and the human body recognizes all those things for thousands and thousands of years. Now you are modifying our molecules, putting them in, you know, boxes and all of that, I mean, in a package, you know, and making them artificial molecules. Now a human body cannot recognize those molecules anymore, and that's why it cannot absorb it as food. So all of you are going to have digestive disorders more and more and more if you do not understand what is natural food that we produce. So this is a very deep science, you know, and I have seen nutritionists, you know, it's a paleo diet, it's a keto diet and all. People are still saying, you know, for certain nutrients, you have to eat meat. For me, that is pretty simple. You are trying to eat that species on the planet that has not broken the science of food. So they get the good nutrients. Okay. Of course, there's a lot of vitamin D. Even in our body, there's vitamin D, there's vitamin, all the vitamins, minerals, and all of that. And those animals who eat food naturally, they will also have an abundance of it. So now, instead of teaching human beings, you know, I think all nutritionists, for the deepest understanding, before they are teaching to the world what is food, for the deepest understanding, they should become farmers. That is one of the reasons I became an organic farmer, because you will see life flowing from the soil. You know, minerals and nutrients, they start in the soil. Okay. And if you have your soil can be organic. What is the meaning of organic? You didn't put chemicals. But then your soil, if you even grow it without putting chemicals, but you grow, you know, three crops in a year, your soil will get demineralized, and there are no minerals in your So somebody can give you a nice, you know, radish and all that, say this is organic. But if it is mineral deficient, you will be mineral deficient. Then you have to go to buy supplements. Okay, so the deepest nutritional sciences come from the soil. So so I respect those people who work with the soil. They know soil biology. Then they create from that soil, they make healthy plants. Okay, that's the first. That's like, I think, kindergarten, you know. You go to kindergarten, if you can grow wonderful plants, then you know how to make food. Then from that food, when you supply it to the human body, you can see how all, you know, illnesses reverse. So I think that's, you know, that's an important thing that I like to share, especially with nutritionists, you know, taking the shortcut, meaning going after the animals, because the animals are trying, you know, getting better food. But I have seen this very deep truth that all of energy and life and food. So I follow a plant-based system for my clients. And I've seen that it detoxifies your body, reverses all of these illnesses, and gives you longer life. You know, Ayurveda. Ayurveda is the science of long life. And that science mainly it goes into vegetarianism. Okay. So the other thing is some mistakes have been made. Because, you know, fruit diet and eating a lot of greens and vegetables and, you know, juicing and all that, raw diet. Okay, some people from my TEDx talk, they got an impression that I'm telling everybody to eat raw food. But I'm not doing that. I'll explain why. And there was a movement, raw food movement, about 20 years back. And people who have been on that complete raw food movement, sometimes after 5, 6, 7 years, they got sick. And now there's a video channel, you know, against those pioneers, where people are saying we all became skin thin, you know, our hair fell off, our skin became dry, because raw food will take your air element high. What has happened is that when we were in nature, we used to get direct sunlight, we used to walk bare feet, so we would get more of the natural elements, you know, earth, water was very good quality, you know, with the correct electrical charge, the correct, you know, nutrients in it and minerals in it. So we used to get more of the natural elements. When we came into this concrete jungle, then we got cut off from those elements. The earth element came down. So now we are in a city without earthing and grounding. So we do need earth element. So that's why I bring in, you know, cooked food, because cooked food gives you more earth element. Nuts, beans, peas, you know, grains, roots. They bring the earth element into your body. And overall, for a person, if you are going more on a raw food diet, you lose more weight and you'll become very skin and thin, you know, and you'll have insomnia, little, you know, loss of sleep at night. So it's a simple indicator that you need to bring more denser, heavier grounding foods into your diet. Okay, and people who overdo the heavy foods, they'll put on more weight. Okay, that's a simple rule for if you're putting on too much weight or losing weight, then you need to see how much of a balance of raw and cooked food you are having. Of course, all of these need to be, you know, natural, organic, and you need to follow a principle of rotation of foods to have get a regular dose of all the minerals, vitamins, fibers, fats, and all of that. Thank you.
Thank you, Daryl. Here's our third question for the panelists. Please let our audience know that they can get in touch with you for your advice on nutrition. How they can get in touch with you for your advice on nutrition. Siddharth, would you like to go ahead?
Yeah, I am very much available on WhatsApp and Facebook. So I will leave my contact number in the chat section with my email ID. You can get in touch with me. Also, you can follow me on the Facebook. And we have a page known as The Earth People. So you can follow that page, and I would be really happy to help you out. Especially people who wants to pursue athletes and, you know, any bodybuilders in the group who wants to go for plant-based diet. Thank you.
Thank you, Siddharth. Dr. Rima?
Well, I'm very passionately following my profession. So I'm very much available in most of the social handles, be it Instagram, Twitter, YouTube, Facebook. I am almost available on all the social handles. The prime reason is that I want to make myself available for all the masses to approach me so that whatever set of information experiences I am having, I can share with them. So they can definitely contact me through all these mediums. They can always email me, send me messages, or they can also contact me through WhatsApp. So I can always share all my links with Daryl, or they can also contact me directly. So I'm very much available for all my audience.
Thank you, Dr. Shikha.
You can visit my clinic, which is in Sangolda. It's called Healthy Healing Center. Or you can also contact me through WhatsApp, through email. You can visit my website and know more about me. I'll put this information in the chat box. So I'm available through phone or through a person in-person contact. One can also have online consultations with me if they are not in Goa and would like to get in touch with me. So you just write me an email and I'll contact you back, and we can consult online as well.
Thank you, Darren.
Yes, to access my work, you can go to my website, darryldesouza.com, and there you will find my first website on health, which is becomehealthyorextinct.com, and please go to that website, download my book, and it's a free download, or if you want a printed copy, you can order for it. So please read through that book and you'll get a lot of, you know, important understandings of how to remain healthy. So that's the first line of, you know, info and education that I give people who want to reverse illness. Now, presently, I'm not taking consultations I think till the end of November, till the whole New Earth Summit series is completed. And maybe in December, I'll open again for consultations. But I do have a online workshop also. It's like a classroom where people get into the classroom and they can do a 12-hour intensive workshop. And that's also available on my website, Become Healthy or Extinct, in the therapy section. So those of you who are in a very, in a hurry to fix certain issues, you can have a look at that workshop and its contents, you know, if it will serve you. And once perhaps, you know, lockdown opens up November, December, hopefully, then I will reopen my center in Goa, the Rejuvenation Center in Kalangut, where we had actually started, we were doing 52 health programs. You know, every Sunday we were doing a health program at the center, but the last one we did when the lockdown happened. So for people in Goa, that would be a good thing. Once we open up again, they can access those programs. Thank you.
Okay, moving to our Q&A round. Here is the first question from the audience, from Preeti. Please suggest what type of food to consume when the patient has pneumonia and COVID-19.
Since I have already treated many patients who were suffering from COVID-19, so first of all, we really need to understand the physiology. This is basically a condition where one man-made virus is attacking your system. I'm precisely using the term man-made because this was not a virus which pre-existed in the planet. And that is why they are using the period of 7 to 14 days, because that's the minimum time our body needs to produce fresh antibodies. And that is why they are using this period 7 to 14 days. And that's why that's a crucial phase. Now, since you have to make sure that your body will produce a lot of antibodies in this period of 7 to 14 days, you have to empower your immune function. So you have to bring your immunity on peak. And that's only possible if you are giving a break to rest of your system. So the very first advice is that start incorporating a lot of vitamin C elements in your diet. It can be sweet lime, it can be sweet lime juice. You need to drink a lot of water so that your system is completely hydrated. You can always have a lot of lemon water in your diet. You can also take coconut water because it's full of electrolytes and it's an elixir of life, actually, a natural elixir. So these are the things you have to incorporate and make sure that you are not eating something which is adding a burden on your digestive tract. As I said, you have to empower your immune function to create fresh antibodies. So for that, you have to give a complete surrounding inside which supports your immune function. So don't eat anything which brings a lot of burden on your digestive tract. So eat very simple diet and something which is very light, and take more of a vitamin C and electrolytes in your diet, and give a complete rest to your body.
Thank you. Would any other panelists like to add to that?
When I was 20 years old, I almost died from pneumonia because I was coughing blood and could not breathe. In the middle of the night, the doctor had to come from Dr. Chodankar from the Chodankar Hospital here in Poverim. He came at 10:30 at night to my house and he saw my condition and he got so scared he ran back and opened his hospital and got some big syringes and he poked me. With that, and that saved my life because he had told my mom that, I'm not going to survive till the morning. So I've seen through that. Of course, it was allopathy to the rescue that, really helped me at that time. But since I had a weak lung condition, then I understood some lessons. So to avoid cough, cold, pneumonia, bronchitis and all that, if you have that tendency, then you should for that time avoid sour foods and vinegar-based foods. Okay, and you should have things like herbal teas like lemongrass or tulsi. What is very important, you need to strengthen your lungs and your chest area. So in my health workshops, I have been giving people a sequence of exercise and breathing. Okay, so the first step is you do about 10 chest presses. Okay, what do you do? Push-ups. You can do against a wall or against your table or against the veranda. You do about 10, 12 of those push-ups so that, really strengthens and brings blood flow over here to the center of your chest. Once a part is exercised, then it's asking for energy. Then I just advise people to do a pranayam. Okay, it's a very simple pranayam with a forced breathing in and out. What does this breathing do? Okay, it strengthens the walls of the lungs first. It supercharges oxygen to your body and your oxygen will pull, your body will pull that oxygen to the part that is just exercised. And that part that is just exercised is your lungs. Okay, so this is how bodybuilders build muscle and fat. How do you build a muscle, right? You exercise it, and then there's a gap and you give it food. And that food goes right over there and starts building. So if you want to build your lungs, this is what you've got to do. Okay, exercise the chest, maybe 10, some people have most 10, 15 push-ups. Then you do about 10 or 15, same count, this pranayam with your eyes closed because prana circulates and remains inside. Then the acupressure ball that I have, I roll it over here, on the where the lungs are and here also lungs. So just rolling the acupressure ball for about 2 minutes, still keeping your eyes closed. Because then the prana remains inside. So our ancient yogis knew all of this. To conserve energy and recirculate in the body, you have to keep your eyes closed. So this is the step one. Push up, then breathing. Then if you don't have a ball, just press your lung points. You can see it in my book. And do this 3 times. Okay, people who have cough and cold and all, without anything else, within 4 days, the cough and cold stops. And then additionally, you can take these herbs like lemongrass, tulsi and all, one in the morning like lemongrass, evening time you can have tulsi or ginger. So these things will really help, with your lung condition. And I had made go to my YouTube channel and there you will see a video that I made in April about immunity, how to increase your immunity so you can fight the virus. I also have a similar view like Dr. Rima that, for me, this in the category of viruses only, it seems unnatural because we all know viruses come and hit us and we take a hit for 5-6 days. Now, from where is this new thing that has come, which has got 14 days of gestation time? So for me, it defies it. I don't think it's a virus. I think it's some other kind of organism that's going around, which causes infection and like pneumonia symptoms. That's what's happening, right? Pneumonia is also caused not by a virus. Called by Klebsiella pneumoniae. It's a very hard shell protozoan bacteria. So while everybody is looking for a virus in the air, I think something else is going on which is being undetected and giving the breathlessness and thrombosis also. And we have also seen that people across the country who have been taking some antibiotics, they have also recovered from the, you know, from this infection. So it's not that an antiviral is saving people. It's actually an antibacterial and an antibiotic that is saving people.
Thank you, Dai. Moving on to our next question from an anonymous attendee. I'm thinking of going vegan, but confused about the kids. Is this okay for kids if they don't consume dairy products? What is the alternative for milk, curd, and ghee in a vegan diet? And what is the thing that has nutritional value equal to ghee?
I actually have a lot of things to say on this. So kids, as Daryl has already mentioned, that we just have to use our common sense that no other mammals drink milk from the other mammal, okay? And then second best example which I can give is like after a certain age, as a child, if I talk about myself, I was not okay with drinking milk, but that kids are not liking the milk. Okay, if you give them raw milk, they will refuse. But we force them to drink that milk. And we have a lot of things, like we have Complan, then we have Bonvita. Sorry if I'm taking brand names, if someone's working in that company. So a lot of things are there. So yes, there is no requirement of giving milk to kids. If they are after a certain age, then they stop drinking mother's milk. There is no need of giving them milk. And alternative of dairy products, for me, there is no alternative because there is no required. Okay, that is not required at all. Whatever alternatives we have, like soya curd or soya shrikhand, and we have vegan ghee also, which is dalda or vanaspati vegetable oil-based ghee. So that is to fool our mind only. Otherwise, there is no requirement of having all that stuff. So there is no question of having alternative. For me, ghee is not healthy at all. Okay, so I have stopped having ghee long time back, and I really don't see any nutritional value of out of it. Yes, previously I was having ghee, but after I left ghee, I don't see there is something missing in my diet. So I hope, in short, that is enough for now. If anything else to be added, I would request other panelists.
Thank you, Siddharth. Would any other panelists like to speak on it?
Okay, so now when we discuss about milk, you know, why people are obsessed about milk or dairy products, it's because they are sourcing major three nutritions out of dairy and dairy products. First is calcium, second protein, and third is some good quality fat. Since now we know that the source itself is manipulated, and it's not going to bring any good to your system. And of course, there is one more theory which Mr. Daryl already discussed, that we technically don't need milk. So now, what are the alternatives to get all these nutritions? So now, Mother Nature has already blessed us with nuts and seeds. Let's talk about almonds. They are full of good fats and protein. You just soak 10 to 20 almonds and you are done for your entire day need. Sesame seeds, they are densely, you know, loaded with calcium. So if you're looking for calcium through milk, you can always add sesame seeds in your diet. So we do have a lot of plant-based alternatives for milk and dairy products. All you just have to just, you know, search a bit. And then you will be able to, you know, get all these nutritional needs through other sources. So nuts and seeds, specifically almonds, walnuts, pumpkin seeds, watermelon seeds, sesame seeds, they are like a great source of protein, good quality fats, and calcium. And of course, a lot of other vitamins and minerals also. So you can definitely replace with all these plant-based things.
Thank you, Dr. Rima. The next question from Nakul. Can thyroid be completely cured by diet? would any of our panelists have to take on?
Absolutely. Because out of 10, I guess, 6 patients of mine, either they are suffering from hypo or hyperthyroidism. Of course, we need an integrated approach. We need to bring a holistic change and we need to address the root cause. If you are having hypothyroidism, that means your gland is underactive, and if it is hyper, that means it's overactive. So whatever thyroxine and levoxin your medicine doctors are giving you, they are just, you know, dealing with the symptoms. Whatever thyroxine is basically a natural hormone your glands produce, your thyroid gland. Since your body is not able to produce this basic hormone, so your medicine doctors are giving you those, you know, pills. So they are basically dealing with the symptoms. So we need to address the root cause, that why your gland is not functioning properly. Whether your gland is underactive or overactive, you have to, first of all, see the reason. What is the root cause behind it? And then we have to come with an integrated approach, be it your diet, your lifestyle. There are so many good yoga postures. I am personally practicing yoga from past 10 years. And I do pranayama, and sarvangasana is a beautiful asana for treating. Then matsyasana, which is a fish pose. It's a beautiful posture for reversing thyroid. So it's an integrated approach and it is 100% reversible. Just 10 days before, one of my patients, she came to me and she was having all the symptoms which a hypothyroid patient must be having. And she herself was not knowing that her TSH level was 11.2. Within 2 months, I said, okay, now again, you go for a report after following this integrated approach with complete discipline. Now her current levels are 3.5, which is within the normal range. So it's 100% reversible as long as we are giving an integrated approach and as long as we are addressing the root cause. So don't just think about that, how you are going to get those hormones. You have to correct the functioning of your thyroid glands.
I would like to add to that, you know, I've seen, it turns out that rice and wheat are not really healthy grains for us. And they are, especially wheat, is contributing to also thyroid dysfunction. And as you already know that Dr. Rima has already knocked out, you know, canceled out wheat from the diet. I would like to add to that also from some research reports I've seen that is the wheat, popular wheat that goes around in the world has gone through 17 mutations. So there is nothing natural left about it. And I have seen that people are reversing thyroid when they, even in my dietary system, I knock out wheat completely. I you know, tell my clients that they can have, you know, semi-polished rice once a day, maybe the for lunch, and I advise, you know, for breakfast millets and for evening dinner also millets. So there is a connection with reducing your wheat and, you know, getting millets in that place, which is I'm seeing is bringing down the, you know, thyroid levels and helping thyroid. And also for the person who has thyroid, at that time avoid eating, you know, anything that's going to irritate your throat. So cruciferous vegetables in their raw state, like cabbage, broccoli, iced lettuce, all the lettuces and all that. If you avoid during that time of, you know, healing your thyroid, it'll heal faster. You can have a little bit of it in a good, you know, cooked condition. And that will help.
Okay, I would like to add one thing over here since we are discussing about thyroid. You know, people usually either they look for hypo or hyper, but there is one more very important category, that's Hashimoto's. And that's directly related to your inflammation in your gut lining. So as soon as you eliminate wheat, as soon as you eliminate all these processed food, you are actually putting a stepping stone to, you know, I mean, reversing this condition. So Hashimoto's is basically nothing, just a, you know, like inflammation in your gut lining. So most of the people are actually suffering from Hashimoto's instead of hyper or hypothyroidism. And Dr. Daryl said it very clearly that cruciferous vegetables, you should not consume it raw because there is one molecule in it which actually interferes in absorption of iodine. So once you cook it, steam it, then that molecule dissolves and then you can easily enjoy these cruciferous vegetables in moderation. So you should definitely steam it and cook it, never have it raw if you are suffering from this condition.
Thank you, Dr. Rima. Thank you, Daryl. Next question from Sonia. Can someone highlight on water toxicity? Is RO water bad? If we purify PWD or well water through RO or filters or boiling, how do you add back the minerals? Is silver, gold, copper water good for the body?
I had said in my last webinar as well that RO water, of course, is not good for health if you look at RO water per se, because RO water is a water which has been leached out of everything. This water has no minerals in it. So when it goes into your system, it will leach out minerals from your system and you'll pass it out in the urine. So drinking pure RO water for a long term is not good. Moreover, RO water is acidic. So what I advise is, of course, and then on the other hand, we do need ROs because of whatever is going on with the water supply system, with the amount of toxins, chemicals, heavy metals, and microbes that are in the water these days. You cannot get rid of them by just boiling them for a long time. Heavy metals will not leave it by boiling. Pesticides will not leave it by boiling. You can remove chlorine, but not fluorides by boiling the water. So you do need RO system to remove a lot of unhealthy stuff. But then you add a carbon filter or an activated carbon filter to your water, which will add some alkalize your water, which will allow you to add some minerals in the water as well. So what you do is take your RO water, buy an alkaline water pitcher or whatever, and you put your RO water in an alkalizing pitcher and alkalize that water, add minerals to it, and then it is good for you. A simple thing is, what I suggest to my people is take a little bit of pink salt, very tiny pinch in every glass of water you drink from RO. That will add minerals to it.
I would like to add one thing. Dr. Shikha said it so well that yes, RO leaches out all the nutrients from your water. So we certainly don't need RO, but unfortunately the quality of water is badly affected nowadays. So maybe a simple plain water filter, or the best thing is just boil your water. Now coming to this point that what if the water is acidic, then how to make it alkaline? So nowadays a lot of people are using alkaline pills or some kind of machines are coming. I give you one very simple tip. Just get an earthen pot. That earthen pot has all the quality to make your water completely alkaline. So if you are storing your water in earthen pot, it will make your water alkaline. It won't be any more acidic, and that is why in olden time, people used to cook food in earthen pots. And that is why I also do such kind of corrections in my patients' kitchens that don't use plastic or these aluminium or all these kind of metals. I always encourage them to use earthen pot or copper or brass in their kitchen. Now, there is one more extra question being asked, whether we should drink copper water or not. So, yes, copper water is good for your body. It's a very important mineral, and especially for your brain. But then unfortunately, you know, people works in the in extremes. So since everybody, you know, I mean, they're getting an information that copper water is good, people are just chugging copper water from copper bottles throughout the day, which is actually increasing the copper toxicity in your system. So you need copper water, but I guess 1 to 2 glass of copper water in a day is more than enough. So if you are having a copper jug, just store 1 to 2 glass of water, keep it overnight, and you can have it in the morning or throughout the day. But don't keep on consuming water from the copper bottle throughout the day, because that's basically going to increase the level of copper in your blood, which create a possibility of toxicity in your system. So go with the approach of balance. So balance is the best way, you know, and buy this earthen pot and start storing water in earthen pot, and you don't need to buy alkaline machines or alkaline pills for storing water.
I actually see in my practice a lot of people with copper toxicity.
Yes.
They drink water from these, you know, it's a fad. Buy a liter copper bottle nowadays and you drink water from that. So many people with copper toxicity these days. It's amazing. Yes. It's amazing. So yes, it's true. You should not drink copper.
Yeah, so, you know, when this is when modern people try to, you know, copy Indian tradition. That were taught by the yogis and all, and that time it was very simple that there was a certain size of a lota only that they would keep overnight, and the practice is when you get up in the morning you just drink that one. Okay, there are no pictures of any Indian yogis roaming around with, you know, copper lotas attached to their bodies. So people take a small idea and they don't know the whole science. And I agree with both Dr. Reema and Dr. Shikha that that leads to copper toxicity if you drink out of the bottle. So you can have a copper bottle and don't even fill the whole bottle. You know, take somewhere at 250 ml. Okay, depending on a person's size, anywhere between 200 to 250, 300 ml. That's all that you must have in the morning. And I also follow the principle of, you know, taking breaks in between. That means you don't have to have it for the rest of your life. You know, you can take it for 10 days and take a 3-day break or a 5-day break and then take it for another 10 days. You know, there's not so much of copper flowing in mountain water and in the well water. We have to understand, you know, balance and logic.
Thank you. Moving on to our next question from Sonia. How do vegetarians compensate for B12? As I heard, its source is from animal products. Can you clarify?
So I'll comment first on this word source. So people get this, you know, yes, I think the source is found in the laboratory, you know, when they're working on those animal cuts of animals, but actual B12 producing bacteria, it is there in the rainwater. It falls onto the ground, it goes into your well water and your streams, and all those bacteria strains of them, they come into your plants also. And once you eat organic and natural plants, then those bacteria also start coming into your body. And if your body, as the B12 is made, if your body doesn't have inflammation and your small intestine doesn't have inflammation, it can absorb that, you know, B12, the vitamin. So that's about the source of B12. So that animal that is running in the wild or that is drinking, you know, groundwater or something like that, or eating natural food off the soil, it is going to have the right strains of bacteria that make B12. But human beings, of course, we don't eat, even the raw vegetables and all. We scrape it off and we clean it and we wash it and do so many things that there's no strains of actual, you know, proper bacteria coming into our system. So what needs a correction is either we correct this habit of ours, or we start getting sources of B12 in a certain way. Now, if you're living in the city, you're not going to get fresh, organically picked up vegetables where all you do is just wash it a little, get off the mud. But there are little strains of bacteria in the cracks of the, you know, in the ridges of the carrot or radish or beetroot and all of that. Tiny strains of bacteria there. And when they go inside, the B12 bacteria will also be there. But now city-based people will not get that fresh food. So we have to supply them certain, there are now capsules for B12 or there's intravenous B12 and all of that. So that is the science, you know. Yes, wild animals, they have a lot of B12. So the main correction is this. That's why I got into organic farming. How can people in various places in the world get a regular supply of organic vegetables where they can get the vegetable, just wash it on the tap without scraping it and all that, how they can eat it and get, you know, a little bit of bacteria? Because it is a fact that as you pass out stools every day from your body, there are strains of bacteria that are leaving. So you need replenishment on a daily level. And when we don't understand this science and we've not been getting bacteria for the last 5-6 years, then you don't have any, you know, bacteria in your system and you show, you know, deficiency of vitamin B12. So the systemic thing is a longer correction. But in the short term, I don't see any other, way than to supplemented with capsules or with, you know, orally or intravenously. Otherwise, the only other option is this, people going back to meats, and then meat brings its own toxicity. You know, when the animal dies, all of those toxic hormones are also there in their flesh. And we are eating all those hormones too. So it brings aggression, frustration, and all of that when we take animal products. So certainly I don't advise anybody, you know, to kind of go into meats because they need vitamin B12. You get, you know, healthy supplements of vitamin B12.
Okay, I would like to add here for the B12 thing. What I do is I regularly have kombucha prepared in our house, kombucha and the tapache, which is made out of pineapple skin. That is the best form of kombucha, we say. So it is a good thing to have for B12, I guess, because I have been taking this since last couple of, since I am vegan, I have been regularly taking this. Even in Delhi area, we do have kanji that our mothers used to prepare, fermented vegetables, cultured vegetables. So we can easily get enough B12 from that. It is already mentioned in the book, Become Healthy or Extinct, cultured vegetables, B12. So I think that that can be added to it.
Thank you. Moving on to our next question from Anthony D'Souza. This is directed to Dr. Shikha. Why do you say that cooking with olive oil is to be avoided, as I do all my cooking with olive oil?
Well, it's simple. Olive oil is one of these monounsaturated oils. You have, if you study the structure, it's an omega-6 rich oil. So there's a lot of unsaturated fat inside. And when you cook an oil with unsaturated fats at a high heat, it breaks these bonds and it denatures the oil. So this oil becomes toxic for you. Olive oil is best eaten raw over salads. It's not so good for cooking, but still I think in Europe, in Italy and all, they use olive oil for cooking. But this olive oil that they use then is like a refined version of olive oil, which will have very few of the omega-6 left in them, or it will be more of the oil version, which if you cook with, has less toxins in it. So I personally believe olive oil, because of its monounsaturated fat content, it should not be cooked. It should be eaten raw for its benefits.
Thank you, Dr. Shikha. Would any of the other panelists like to add to that?
Yes. I love to answer this question. First of all, we have to stop copying West. You know, people are blindly just copying West, and that is why they are creating more toxicity in this system. First of all, when we talk about cooking, we need to understand that what is our format of cooking. And we need to understand the very simple science of smoking point. Why Western people are so okay with the olive oil and why we Indians cannot use olive oil for cooking, the very simple reason is that Western people, they are not much into detail, you know, cooking at a high smoking point. At the most, what they do is just stir fry. Or they normally just take raw foods and, you know, do salad dressings. Fine, omega-3, omega-6, olive oil is dense with it. But it doesn't have a high smoking point. So as soon as you start using olive oil in your Indian kitchen for all your basic cookings, so because it has low smoking point, it will get acidic quickly. And whatever food you are preparing in that oil get toxic. So even if you're looking to add olive oil in your diet to get that omega-3 and omega-6, you can have a good quality virgin olive oil in the most raw form. You can just, you know, put it for a salad dressing or something. But it doesn't have a high smoking point. So you have to look for the local oils which is available. For example, for the West Coast, like it's coconut oil is the best. And cold pressed coconut oil has a very high smoking point. So you can easily do Indian cooking in coconut oil. And if you are in North, Then kachi ghani mustard oil, a very simple cold pressed mustard oil is good for them. Because again, it has a high smoking point. And even pure cow ghee has a high smoking point. So you can easily use all these oils in your kitchen. So that is why, you know, I mean, if you see the basic wisdom, the basic science, you will see that people who are living in Western Coast, they are using coconut oil because coconut is available in abundance. And if you're using a cold press form, then this is the best option for you for your Indian cooking. So olive oil doesn't have a high smoking point. So don't use olive oil for cooking. And the kind of new, you know, version of olive oil, which is with a refined oil mix and all, that is anyways not natural. So you're not going to get any omega-3 or omega-6 out of it. Forget about the smoking point. It's refined. It's synthetic. It's processed. It's no more natural. It's going to create a lot of toxicity in your system. So that is why you have to stop following West. Just see what's in your local surroundings and you will get all the answers of your questions that what you should use in terms of your ingredients in your kitchen.
Thank you. The next question from Bhavana, directed to Daryl. Is it true that you don't get your protein after a few years of WFPB diet, which causes a lot of hair fall, etc.? And also, how is emmer wheat safe to eat instead of regular wheat?
I didn't get that diet.
It is whole food, plant-based.
Okay, yeah. Whole food, plant-based diet. Yes, so that is a short form of it. It's not true at all that a plant-based diet, you know, that's where protein is made. So you get enough of protein if you have all the, you know, proper range of nutrition. And emmer wheat, it will have a little lesser gluten than the normal wheat. So in comparison, it will show better results if we eat emmer wheat than, you know, the current popular wheat that is there in the world.
Yeah, so that's what you would like to add to.
Yeah, surely. First of all, there is a lot of myth about protein. You know? Everyone is, I don't know why everyone is after protein. Protein is in everything. I mean, even if I'm eating an apple or a banana, protein is in it. We are made out of protein. Yes, protein helps in the construction of our body, and after a certain age, we don't need that much protein in our diet. But whatever we are eating, it already has a protein in it. As even a single fruit is a, if we take a fruit, it has everything what is required, whatever is required by the body. Even if a person is into some heavy exercise or workout, we definitely have to add some protein. But plant-based protein is better absorbed by the body as compared to meat-based protein. And the sprouts, almonds, broccoli, and peanut butter, these are the two best source of protein. Thank you.
Hair fall is happening, does happen, of course, due to more of vayu or air in the body. So it could be that this person is, you know, you're having too much of raw food also, because raw food is such a fad. I mean, typically for my clients, when they are overweight, okay, and they, when they look to lose a lot of weight, we increase the amount of, you know, fruits and vegetables and salads and all that. So, and we typically, of course, knock off wheat completely and even reduce rice and put them on millets. So at that time, you know, the weight loss is pretty good and quick, fast. Within 2-3 months, you know, you'll see 8 kilos, 10 kilos, 12 kilos, 15 kilos going. But people need to realize that this is not the permanent diet. Okay, it's being done to achieve certain thing. And once the desired, you know, diet is reached, people are still on that old thing of that much of raw food helped me, and, you know, drinking a smoothie, raw smoothie every day helped me. So it could be that, you know, once you reach that level, then you need to bring in little more earth, you know, the heavier foods back and reduce your raw food intake and have a little more, increase your amount of cooked food. And you need to have regular amount, you know, of the omega-3, omega-6 oil. You need to have your nuts, beans, peas and all, because they will create the oils that will nourish your scalp. So look at that. Okay, if you're doing too much raw food and if you're not having enough of natural oils in your diet, from of course the original components of food. I don't advise people to have fried food at all. Instead of, if they want cooked food, I advise baking, boiling, roasting, steaming. And now you have the air fryer also. So there are five modes of cooking food. You can drop that sixth one, which is fried food. Because in my diet, it's detailed. Too much of fried foods, how it leads to a diabetic condition also. Okay, so read up that section in my book on food and diabetes.
Thank you. Moving on to our next question from anonymous attendee. What foods needs to be avoided by an adult who is on medication for epilepsy? And to add on, no seizure has happened from 4 to 5 years.
I can say what foods they should take if they have epilepsy. I think epilepsy, yeah. Epilepsy is a condition where the nerves are super excited. So the foods they need to avoid are the foods which will increase their glutamate levels in the brain. So MSG, anything with Ajinomoto, they have to avoid everything with Ajinomoto for sure. Then, that's one of the most important things. High glutamate foods they need to avoid. That's all I can say. But one thing I have studied a lot, and I don't have personal experience, but others, doctors, friends of mine have had, is for epilepsy, the best diet is keto diet to begin with. If they go on a good high fat diet, it can take away seizures sometimes for good. So you avoid foods with MSG and try and go towards eating foods on a very high fat diet. That would help epilepsy patients. Thank you.
So we can move on to our next question from Abhay Mahurle. How does plastic bottles water affect us?
Yeah, of course, with plastic, it's got its own toxic molecules, and especially when it's, heated. So we keep, water in a plastic bottle, and then we don't know for how long and where it stays in our car. That's the worst place, to have anything, whatever grade of plastic. I never recommend people to have water and plastic bottles out at any time. And the car is the worst. Okay, you need to have a stainless steel container, a flask, that would be much better. So, yes, there are enough research which shows that, plasticized water is slowly creating toxicity in the human body and inflammation also. So, best avoided.
All right, moving on to our next question from Abhay Morule. Can we intake fruits which have been tasted or bitten by birds like parrot, cuckoo, etc.?
So actually, I always hunt for kind of fruits in market, which are bitten by the parrot or a bird. And I always give extra bucks to that vendor or farmer who is giving me those fruits, which is a good sign that the fruit is a good ripened one and it is better to other units. So yes, of course, you can eat it. You will enjoy it.
But yeah, I would
this
like
is my to... opinion. Over to you.
Yes, yes. So that's one side of the story, and I'll give you the other side of the story. If your parrot or your cuckoo is a domestic one, and you know that it's very healthy, then okay, that's probably safe. But and also, of course, if it's on the vendor cart and if there's any bad bacteria or something bad with it, then that part of the fruit will start getting spoiled. Okay, so don't touch that. But yeah, if it's with your house pets and they are pretty healthy, then you can go ahead and have that fruit. Otherwise, you don't want to hear another, article in the newspaper that instead of coronavirus, something else virus came out of, of the cuckoo. So be careful with the wild animals. Yeah, they have some wild.
It is. I am talking about if we are in a village or kind of environment, but in the cities, you know, first of all, we don't have any birds. Even though birds are there, they are always around some messy place, so it can be harmful.
So another insight, you know, a point to ponder, which is for all people who are afraid of, you know, coronavirus and this whole story of that the virus came from a bat in the jungle and all that. And viruses do come from the jungle and come into our, you know, through different animals. The facts are the people who are living in the jungle, right? Whether it's the Amazon rainforest or whether it's the aboriginals and, you know, in the Australian outback and all remote places, right? They are living with all those viruses, you know, around them all the time. And there is no pandemic happening over there, okay? And they are not getting all of these conditions. So that's a very big question, you know, what is actually going around in this world? Does a virus do this kind of damage or is it something else?
Thank you. Moving on to our next question from Andrea. How do we increase the immunity of children during the COVID times?
Children or adults, it's pretty much it applies to everybody. You can increase your immunity by, you know, like the first question that was discussed for pneumonia and COVID, what you need to do is whatever suggestions were given were exactly for raising your immunity. So making sure that you sleep well, making sure that you are eating healthy, you avoid junk food, avoid a lot of fried and refined foods, go for eating a lot of fruits, especially citrus fruits, which will add more vitamin C to your system. Make sure your vitamin D levels are good. And sometimes, especially these days, sun alone is not enough for vitamin D because of our dark skin. Plus lack of proteins in our body, we do not make enough vitamin D from sunlight, which is a raw material. Sunlight is a catalyst in some chain reaction, which will allow you to make vitamin D. But if you don't have the raw material, you will not make vitamin D from sun. So make sure you have good vitamin D levels in your body. Make sure you have increased your vitamin C by taking citrus fruits. And if actually your health is not good already, you make sure you take vitamin C orally per se. You do take some vitamin C, 2,000, 3,000 milligrams in a day. That will help you to improve your immunity. And for kids, they can take about 1,000 milligrams of vitamin C, or you make sure they eat good amount of fruits. And for kids especially, because they are at home, they are not going to school, they are bothering you, don't give them candies all the time to keep them sharp. And make sure they're not sitting in front of the screen all the time. They are playing. There is some kind of a games that they do. They don't sit in front of the computer, either attending online classes or then going for games, online, you know, computer games. Move, sleep well, eat fruits, and if needed, take vitamin C and vitamin D. You will improve your immunity. Thank you.
Yes, I would like to add to that about, you know, immunity. One part is of increasing your present immunity by, you know, doing additional things. Vitamin C, you know, very good. I also follow that. But the first part for me fundamentally before that is, can we stop doing certain things that are bringing down our immunity every day? Okay, so very shortly, I'll mention something, but go to my YouTube channel and you will see that there are actually two videos. They are webinars, both of them. One I did in April and then one in May. Okay. And there I've given the 5-6 points that, you know, drop our immunity. One of them was, of course, all of this, you know, not stopping the wrong foods and eating the right foods. The second one was stop all of these processed foods from the malls, okay, all these man-made foods, because all of those molecules and atoms, they are imbalanced, and when they're in the package, they that's why you have the stabilizer, this chemical called a stabilizer, because if it's not put in, then all these artificial tasting agents, preservatives, and, you know, flavoring agents and coloring agents, they will react with them, with each other, and spoil the food. So we literally have atomic warfare going on in that, you know, tight unit. and we bring it to our house, and then we put it inside our body, and then we allow atomic warfare to happen, you know, in our system. That's how you got get inflammation in your entire gut system. So now, if you are going to be having these things at a regular level, if you're going to have fried foods at a regular level, so your whole immune system is engaged by fighting and protecting the body from all of this. Then besides that, I've also mentioned that people who are on, you know, allopathic medicines for high BP, cholesterol, diabetes, and all of that in the long term, they do some damage to your kidneys, your liver, your spleen, your heart, and all of that. So it is obvious that something takes away your headache, something takes away your constipation, but it does a slow damage to the other parts of the body. That means this is what is comorbid, right? All the comorbid people are having a higher death rate. That is because they're engaged, their immune systems are engaged with, managing that medication that's there in the body. And lastly, I said, take off all these electricities from around you, like, you know, Wi-Fi and too much of Bluetooth, because those energies also get into your body, and your body, again, your energy system of your body is engaged in maintaining its fields and bouncing off those bad electricities out. So if you have all these 1, 2, 3, 4, you know, 5, 6 things working against your immunity, then let's say each of them is, using up 10% of your immunity. So literally you have 50% of your immunity engaged with all of this. And you just have 50% of immunity left to fight the virus. Okay, so it's very simple. Knock off all of these things. There was even an article in a Goa paper that where I gave all of these points. So we need to stop doing all these wrong things, and then reclaim that 50% immunity. Let us all have immunity that's working somewhere at least 80% or something, and then I can safely say that no virus is going to touch anybody or harm anybody who even has the immunity up to 75-80%. I think on average, human beings, their immunity levels are, running, they're engaged. 50% of the time, our immunity is engaged with all this rubbish that we're doing. And we don't even have half of our immunity ready to fight some virus, bacteria, fungus, mold, whatever it is.
Thank you. We have reached the end of today's webinar. Thank you to all our panelists for such valuable information, and thank you to all our attendees for being with us.